Chapter number 1, verse number 18. Listen to your Bible. The Bible says, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Amen. On this morning, I'd like for us to consider for a subject, the message of the cross. And I'd like to add on that a subtitle, if you will, the stick and the serpent. The stick, church, and the serpent. Believe it or not, there are many populations out in the world in which we live today. Really, two populations. You have the saved and the unsaved. And believe it or not, there are those who, when they hear the word of God, it sounds like foolishness to them. I mean, what does what took place on the cross over 2,000 years ago have to do with me getting a promotion on the job? What does what happened on the cross over 2,000 years ago have to do with me and my family today? What does what happened on the cross have to do with whether or not we move from the East Coast to the West Coast? And so there is a population of people who hear the word of God and are unable to make sense of the message of the cross and its relevance to our lives even unto this day. But I want to stop by and encourage you to listen very closely, because the message of the cross is the power of God. And I want us to understand, a lot of time when people think about the power, they think about authority, and God does have authority. When people think about power, they think about rule, and God does have rule. When people think about power, perhaps some are thinking about nuclear power, that type of destructive power. But I want us to understand that the kind of power that is most relevant to our lives, even unto this day, from time to eternity, is the transformative power of God to change a man from the guttermost to the uttermost. I want us to know that God can change your life. When we look at Romans chapter number 1 and verse number 16, Paul says, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation for everyone that believes." The transformative power of God has the potential, amen, to transform the life of those that are willing to experience true life with King and Christ Jesus. But again, as the Apostle Paul mentions, to a particular population, the message of the cross is foolishness, but to those that are being saved. And it is our prayer that you will and that you have the desire to be saved. It is the power of God, amen, unto salvation. And so that's what we want to talk about on this morning. And I want us to understand very clearly that the message of the cross did not begin at the cross, but the message of the cross began in the mind of God. When you turn the page over to Colossians chapter number 1, in Colossians chapter number 1 and verse number 19 and verse number 20, we want to explore the message of the cross, and we want to look in particular to the understanding, the mysterious understanding of the stick and the serpent. But in Colossians chapter number 1 and verse number 19 and 20, listen to your Bible. The Bible says, "For it pleased the Father that in him all the fullness should dwell, and by him to reconcile all things to himself, by him, whether things on earth or things in heaven." Here it come. "Having made peace," the Bible says, "through the blood of his cross." And so if there's going to be peace, amen, the peace is going to come at a price. And the price for peace is that old rugged cross. We have to understand that God put a high premium on, amen, sin. Sin comes at a price, amen, and the price of sin is death. Amen. When we look over in Romans chapter number 1 and verse, Romans chapter 6 and verse number 23, the Bible lets us know, amen, that, amen, Romans chapter 6 and verse number 23, the Bible lets us know, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. And so there is a cost for sin. And I stop by to remind us and let us know that the cross, amen, was the cost for sin. When you look over in Genesis chapter number 2, and Genesis chapter number 2 and verse number 17, Genesis chapter number 2 and verse number 17, listen to your Bible. The Bible says, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you will surely die. God gave a command, a prohibitive command, to let man know where not to go. You shall not trespass. You shall not go beyond God's law. And at this time, in Genesis 2, there wasn't but one law, not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It is the law of sin and death, which lets us know that if you sin, you will die. Well, Bible students understand that in Genesis chapter number 3, we see the fall of man. And as a result of the fall of man, we see that God cursed the serpent, God cursed the woman, God cursed the man, and God cursed the ground. I want us to understand the gravity of sin and how God deals with sin, and that yet the mercy of God in spite of our sin. And so when we look in Genesis chapter number 3 and verse number 14 and following, God cursed the serpent. He let the serpent know, amen, that you're going to, amen, on your belly you shall go. In other words, you shall crawl. You're going to eat dust. Amen. And so the serpent, amen, Satan slithered on by. But then he speaks to the woman, and God pronounced his curse upon the woman. And God lets her know that in childbirth you're going to have pain, part of that curse. But not only that, your desire is going to be for your husband. Your desire for dominance is going to be toward your husband. And then he cursed the man. He let the man know that the ground is cursed for your sake. And now, in order for you to eat, you're going to have to involve yourself in hard labor. You're going to have to endure hard labor if you're going to eat. The ground is not just going to yield itself to you. And so we see the discipline of God at the advent of sin in human history. But I want us to notice something very particular in verse number 15. Again, we're talking about the message of the cross, in particular, the stick and the serpent. In Genesis chapter number 3 and verse number 15, listen to your Bible. The Bible says, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. What is it that we have discovered? The Bible lets us know that God put enmity or hostility between Satan and the woman. Amen. And then the Bible lets us know that there are going to be two seeds. There's going to be the seed of the devil. Amen. That's going to come forth from the woman. There's going to be God's seed, a godly seed, and a demonic seed, or those that, amen, will not humble themselves to God. And so you find the seed of Satan, and you find the seed, capital S, that's going to come from the lineage of the woman, and that particular seed is Christ Jesus. And so we have the prophetic word that lets us know that there's going to be conflict, but at the end of the conflict, Jesus is going to get the victory. Now, you missed your shout. That's where you should get your shout on, because the Bible lets us know that he, the Satan, shall bruise his, Jesus' heel. It is a picture of Jesus stomping on the head of Satan, which is, amen, the serpent. And the serpent, by virtue of being stomped on by the Lord, amen, amen, is going to have a mortal wound. And so we need to know that even though man messed up, Christ, our Savior, have come to fix up what we messed up, and Jesus can do it. Now, when we talk about the stick and the serpent, it's important that we understand that the serpent has been a universal symbol of evil. The serpent has been a universal symbol, if you will, of Satan. When you look over in Exodus chapter number 4, in Exodus chapter number 4, verse 2 through verse number 3, Exodus chapter 4, verse 2 through verse number 3, listen to your Bible. The Bible says, "So the Lord said to him," see, God was commissioning Moses to go tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And Moses was hesitant about this assignment from God. And so God says to Moses in Exodus 4 and 2, "What is that in your hand?" Moses responds, "A rod." And God says, "Cast it on the ground." And when Moses cast that rod or that stick on the ground, the Bible lets us know it became a serpent. And as a result, Moses fled away from the serpent. There is a natural affinity in man to repel from a snake. That snake, that symbol of evil, that symbol of Satan, calls Moses to run away, to flee from that serpent, which used to be a stick. God had to tell him to come back here, pick up that serpent by the tail, and it became a stick one more again. So I want us to understand that there is a correlation between the stick and the serpent. Turn your Bibles, if you will, to John chapter number 3. In John chapter number 3, we're going to see a parallel of Jesus himself to an event that took place in the book of Numbers. In John chapter number 3, verse 13 and verse number 14, listen to your Bible. "No one," Jesus says, listen to him, "has ascended to heaven, but he who came down from heaven, that is the Son of Man who is in heaven." There's a whole lot of meat in that we don't have time to get to, but I do want you to understand that God is our omnipresent. In other words, he's everywhere at the same time. While Jesus was on the earth, he was also in heaven all at the same time. And so Jesus says that the Son of Man who is in heaven, look at verse number 14, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness," listen to Jesus, "even so the Son of Man must be lifted up." Amen. And so I want us to recognize that what Jesus is talking about is an event that took place in Numbers chapter 21. Look at Numbers chapter 21, verse 4 through verse number 9. And this is very important for us to understand as we seek to reconcile or correlate, understand the mystery of the stick and the serpent, the mystery of the will of God, or the message of the cross. In Numbers chapter number 21, the children of Israel were in Egypt. Not in Egypt, they were in the wilderness. And in the wilderness, they were frustrated. It was hot. Amen. And the only food that they had was the manna, gracious manna that God had rained down and given them to eat. But the children of Israel got tired of God's provision. And the Bible lets us know that they loathed and they called God's manna worthless bread. Amen. And as a result, amen, of fighting against God and complaining against God and against Moses, God allowed fiery serpents. And the Bible is very descriptive about that adjective, fiery serpent. It ain't just no regular garden snake, but it was a venomous snake, a hostile snake, snakes that would come in among the people and bite the people with ferocious intent, deadly intent, venomous snakes. You know, when you think about snakes, some of them are red and black, and some of them look like a copperhead snake. Some of them look like a black mamba. I don't care if it's a green snake. To me, it looks venomous. But I want us to understand that what came in among the people at church were fiery serpents. And so in verse number 8 and verse number 9 of Numbers 21, the Bible says, "Then the Lord said to Moses," watch this now, "make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole." We're talking about the stick and the serpent. "And it shall be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, shall live." Verse number 9. So Moses made a bronze serpent and put it on a pole. And so it was that if the serpent had bitten anyone, how many of you recognize that we've all been bitten by the serpent? I want us to understand that the devil then had his way with all of us. And I know that's true because Romans 3:23 lets us know that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You might have been bitten in one way and I might have been bitten in another, but we've all been bitten by that serpent of old called the devil. And so he lets us know that Moses is to make this bronze serpent, to put it on a stick or a pole. And when anyone who was bitten looked at it, the bronze serpent, he or she would live. I want us to notice, amen, the amazing symbol of what Christ accomplished on an old rugged cross that is comparative to what took place here in Numbers chapter number 21. And so if the people were to live, they had to look to the serpent. Well, the Bible lets us know that Moses had to form the serpent, and the serpent was a brass or a bronze serpent. I want us to understand that in order for Moses to create this bronze serpent, fix this bronze serpent on a pole, that brass, that bronze had to be beaten. And I want us to understand that that is a picture of what took place on Calvary over 2,000 years ago. And I want to share with us, amen, the relevance of what took place then to our lives even unto this day. And so when you think about the serpent that was put on a pole, having to be beaten and shaped to fit on a pole, it is a picture of the judgment of God to form Christ into the thing that beat the people, that bit the people. And so we have to think about that, because when we go back into our Bibles, we learn that before Jesus got on the old rugged cross of Calvary, he was scourged. And scourging was a method of torture by the Roman government that took place in Jesus' day. The instrument that was used to deliver this form of torture or punishment has been known as the cat of nine tails. And basically what it is a short rod that has thongs that are affixed to the rod. And on the end of the thongs, amen, they would have lead weights, or they would have bones, and it was designed to weigh it down and cause laceration on the body. It was specifically designed to split and to break the skin, to cause laceration. And so this instrument was used to inflict, amen, mortal wounds on a particular prisoner. There was a historian by the name of Eusebius, and this individual was from the city of Caesarea. And during biblical days, he would document many of the events that took place. And so when you go back and you get some historical account of scourging to get a sense of what that was like, what that really entailed, he lets us know that those that witnessed the scourging were thrown back. In other words, they were amazed, they were shocked, because when a prisoner was scourged, He had lacerations. He had busted arteries as a result of being tied to a pole and a Roman soldier splitting his back with this cat of nine tails. And so the veins would be exposed. The arteries would be exposed. The hidden parts of the body would be exposed. The bowels of a man would be exposed. In other words, the hidden part. And so it was not uncommon for the intestines of an individual to literally hang out as a result of the torture of scourging as a prisoner was beaten. And many of them, survive the scourging. But I want us to understand that my Lord refused to die. He could have very well died from the scourging. The Bible lets us know he mumbled not a word. And if you know the nature of man, sometimes when you're getting a beating and the one that's administering the beating wants to hear the response of the pain that he's inflicting on you. And I can see Jesus not mumbling a word and as a result infuriating, amen, the punisher to hit him harder and to rip and to, injure him all the more. And Jesus said not a word, but at the same time, he refused to die. And I want us to understand the reason he refused to die because he had to make the correlation between the stick and the serpent. Jesus on the cross of Calvary became the picture of what the serpent was in the wilderness. And again, when we look back at Numbers chapter 21 and verse number 8, God told Moses, amen, to form, amen, that brass serpent on a pole. In other words, God is saying that I'm going to cure you with the same thing that's killing you. Isn't God something? God says, I'm going to cure you. Amen. Amen. I'm metaphorically speaking here. I'm paraphrasing. I'm going to cure you with the same thing that's killing you. I want you to know that even today, if an individual was bitten by a venomous snake, in order for him to recover, he's going to need some anti-venom. And anti-venom is made from the venom of that particular snake. And it can cure the individual that was bit by that particular snake. The flu is the same way. If you were to get a flu shot, they take dead cells of the virus of the flu and inject it in your body. And your body responds as if the cells of the flu are alive, and it builds up a resistance to protect you from the virus. And so I want us to understand that God had given a vaccine to man. God had given an anti-venom to man in his own begotten son who died on Calvary's cross. Now, here's what God did not say. God did not say to Moses that I want you to put a dove on a pole. He didn't say that. He did not say that I want you to put a raven on the pole. He did not say I want you to put a bull or a goat on the pole. But rather he said I want you, amen, to put a bronze serpent on the pole. And when Jesus correlated Numbers 21 with John chapter number 3, we find that Jesus metaphorically was the serpent on that very pole. When you look at John chapter number 12 and verse number 32, Jesus said, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto myself. And so Jesus, amen, is going to be transformed into the same thing that's killing you and I. We've all been bitten, amen, by that serpent. But God wants us to know that if you just look, you can live. If you remember in Matthew chapter number 7, verse number 7 and verse number 8, Jesus says, amen, amen, that if you seek, you shall find. I want us to understand that if we just look to Jesus, if we come to him in our time of need, and every man needs the Lord, and you need him right now. But if you come to Jesus, he can heal What is ailing you? When I meditated about what perhaps took place in the wilderness, I can see many of those who had parched throats as a result of being bit by a viper. I can see many of them having fevers as a result of being bitten by the viper. I can see many of them experiencing hallucinations as a result of being bit by the serpent. But if you just were to look up, and God says, I want you to look at the same thing that's biting you. And if you look at it, you will live. When we look over in 2 Corinthians chapter number 5 and verse number 21, the Bible lets us know, Paul says, and he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So the Father made the Son who knew no sin to be sin for us. Why? That we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And so when Jesus was on the cross of Calvary, he literally became sin for us. Jesus Christ, as you know, committed no sin. But when he was on the cross, although he never lied, he became a lie. When Jesus was on the cross, although he never stole, amen, he became a thief. Jesus on the cross, amen, although he was never an adulterer, he became an adulterer. In other words, he didn't commit the act, but he symbolized the act when he was, amen, lifted up on Calvary's cross. And so we have to recognize what took place. And what's very special about what happened on the cross is the fact that physically, if a copperhead snake bit you, you need anti-venom from a copperhead snake. If a black mamba bit you, you need anti-venom from the black mamba snake. But here's Jesus, and Jesus can cure whatever it is that ails you. Amen. You missed your shout. Whatever you are struggling with, when Jesus was fashioned on that pole and beaten unmercifully, he became sin for us that he might cure us of what's ailing us all at the same time. When you think about the Garden of Gethsemane in Matthew chapter 26 and verse number 39, the cross was so horrific, y'all, that Jesus prayed three times. And he said, Father, let this cup pass. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. I want us to understand that Jesus was in no way afraid to die. When you look at John chapter number 10, in John chapter number 10, verse number 17 and verse number 18, I want you to know when he asked his Father to let this cup pass, it's not that he was afraid to die, because he was planning to be raised from the dead. In John chapter number 10, verse 17 and verse number 18, listen to your Bible. The Bible said, therefore, my Father loves me because I lay down my life that I may take it again. Verse 18, Jesus says, no one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. And so when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and praying to his Father, let this cup pass, it's not because he became somehow afraid to die. It's not because he was somehow afraid of nails. When we look at John chapter number 12, I want us to understand that Jesus planned to be lifted up. And the term or the notion to be lifted up meant to everybody in that their day, crucifixion. So when Jesus used the vernacular lifted up, his audience knew what that meant. They knew that that meant crucifixion by the hands of the Romans. When you look at John 12 and verse number 32, Jesus says, and if I be what? Lifted up from the earth, will draw all peoples, he says, to myself. Amen. Verse number 33, listen to your Bible. This he said, signifying by what death he would die. So Jesus was signaling to the people how he would die. Look at verse number 34. The people show you that they understood what Jesus was saying. In verse 34, the people answered him. What did they say? We have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. And how can you say the Son of Man must be what? Lifted up. So when Jesus said lifted up, they knew that he was talking about crucifixion. And if you're talking about crucifixion, you are sure enough talking about nails. I want us to understand that it wasn't death that troubled my Lord. It wasn't the nails that troubled the Lord. But on the cross of Calvary, y'all, you got to understand this. Jesus, amen, pleads with his Father, asked the question in Matthew chapter 27 and verse number 46. He says, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which is translated, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And so the notion of death was not the issue. The notion of the nails was not the issue. The issue was being separated from his Father. And so we have to understand the horror of the cross. But then we have to look at it from heaven's point of view. A lot of times we look at the cross from an earthly point of view. But from a heavenly point of view, with Jesus on the cross, having become sin for us, literally, God had to forsake his only begotten Son. Because in that very moment, y'all, Jesus became the symbol of every wicked, every lustful, every craven, every devious, every conniving, every satanic, every witchcraft endorsing, every child molesting, every rape murdering, every serial killing, every mass suicide, every national genocide activity that could ever happen. So Jesus became that on the cross. And we serve a holy God that refuses to be in the presence of sin. And when Jesus was on the cross, the Father had to turn his back on the Son. Amen. Imagine the terror. Imagine the horror. Imagine, amen, being having your Father turn his back on the Son. And why did he do it? Because when Jesus was on the cross, he was the icon, amen, of what was smitten by God. In other words, when God from the balcony of heaven reached back and came forward and slapped the Son, I want you to know that what he was really slapping was sin. He was slapping our sin. And the Son of God was willing, amen, to be slapped by glory, to be rejected by glory, for you and I to have peace with the divine. And so when Christ became the embodiment of sin, he judged my sins on Calvary, so that when I obey the gospel of King and Christ Jesus, I can become free from my sin. And how can I become free from my sin? Because I have become justified by Almighty God. All because God was willing to cast my sin on Calvary's cross. And so this is good news. We have to appreciate, amen, the stick and the serpent. Because Jesus did for us what we could not do for ourselves. Jesus died not just for us, but he died instead of us. And if you want to be a participant, a beneficiary of the cruel cost of Calvary, which was what Jesus was paying over 2,000 years ago, then you need to become a child of the Most High God. In Romans chapter number 8 and verse number 1, the Bible lets us know there is therefore now in the present, no condemnation to them that are do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. And so we have to recognize that we are living in a time right now where we can, amen, absolve ourselves from the error of our way by being hidden in King and Christ Jesus. Praise be the Lord. We had an individual, I can call him Brother Cooper now, that was added to the body of Christ on yesterday. I want our audience to know that it doesn't have to be Sunday for an individual to be baptized. I want an individual to know that when you hear the good news of Jesus Christ and you can make the correlation between what Jesus did and your life today, when you recognize that time don't wait for no man, if you ever get out of bed and you get sore sometime, that's time's way of letting you know that time is running out, that it's creeping up on you. We have a small window that's called time to do one thing, and that is to get right with God. Brother Cooper, the first thing that he said when I met him is that he recognized that it's time to get right. He's been listening to the good news of Jesus Christ. He's been able to make the correlation between peace with God and peace, amen, on the earth. Amen. Why seek the peace on the earth when there's no peace with God? You got to get right with an almighty God who loves you enough to send his only begotten son. And I want us to understand, and I told Brother Cooper on yesterday, that the most difficult part of becoming a child of God, amen, you don't have to be beaten, amen, like that bronze serpent. You don't have to be scourged like Jesus was scourged, amen. But you do have to obey the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The majority of people want to be saved. The majority of people believe that that God is who he says he is. There's a lot of people that believe that Jesus is the Son of God. They're the people that want to be saved, want to have no problem with baptism if they understand that this is a requirement of God, amen, to be a beneficiary of salvation. But the problem that most people have is repentance. And what I want us to understand is that Jesus was willing to bear the cross, but he's not going to bear the cross alone. You're going to have to bear your cross as well. You're going to have to stop that smoking, stop that drinking, stop that fornication, stop that gambling. Everything that God tells us not to do, amen, is for our good. There's nothing that God tells us we can't have that's good for us. Amen. And so what we have to do is we have to trust in God. God wants us to live a holy life. God wants us to get it right before it's a day and everlasting too late. The horrors of hell, amen, you don't want to have to endure. And so what God wants us to do is to choose life. And he made it possible through the stick and the serpent. Allowed his son to become all manner of evil that you might be free. And so, Brother Cooper, I'm so proud of him on yesterday to say yes to the cross. He's got a lovely wife, and both of them are now in the body of Christ, members of the Church of Christ, serving the Lord at the Goose Creek Church of Christ. I'm so excited about all of that because they can help one another along this wilderness journey. And so if you want to become a child of God, you got to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. Romans 10:17. So then faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You got to believe the message that you have heard. There's nothing that I've told you that is absolutely 100% not true. Check the book, take a look. And so you need to put your faith in King and Christ Jesus. Put your faith in the word of God. Believe what thus said the Lord. One thing God cannot do is lie. And so you need to deposit your soul into safekeeping. Once you have believed the message of the cross, you have to repent of your sin. And this is the hardest thing for folk to do because they want to be saved, but they're not willing to bear their cross. Amen. I want us to understand that it's not going to be easy and every day ain't going to be Sunday. But God can help us, amen, to get over what's holding us back. And so Jesus is willing, amen, to take your load. He says, amen, amen, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul, Matthew 11:28. So Jesus wants, amen, to bear your load. Let God handle your load. Amen. Repent of your sin, confess Jesus to be Lord, and be baptized. In Galatians 3:26, the Bible lets us know, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. He said, for many of you as are baptized into Christ have put on Christ. You need to put on Christ. Too many people just feel okay. This message is for a reason. The reason for the message is your response. God is calling you through the gospel. He's calling you to say yes to his cross, that you might bear your cross. And Jesus said, I'll help you with it. I'll help you bear your load. But what you have to decide is who you're going to live for. Are you going to live for, the devil? Amen. There ain't but two seeds. There's Satan's seed and there is the seed, a godly seed. And you want to be a godly seed, but you got to follow the God man, and that's Jesus the Christ. So we pray that you'll make the decision to say yes to the cross. We pray that somehow you've made the correlation between what took place over 2,000 years ago and peace here today. You can't have peace if you're not right with God. A lot of things can happen, but when you cross the border from time to eternity, all your opportunities have expired. And so today is the day. If you want to become a child of God, give us a call at 843-824-1217. If you want to become a child of God, reach out to us on our website, www.goosecreekchurchofchrist.com. We want you to understand the will of God. But most of all, there's a response. And the response is in your hand. And you have the final ballot. You have the final vote relative to where you're going to spend eternity. The devil is against you. God is for you. But you have the deciding ballot. And we pray you'll say yes to the cross before it's a day and everlasting too late. And so contact us at the Church of Christ in Goose Creek. Reach out. Let's get your life together with God. Don't die separated from God and hoping that you'll be all right. You can know right now whether you are all right. Amen. Through the obedience of the gospel. So we love you with the love of the Lord. And we pray again that you'll say yes to the cross through the obedience of the gospel, that you may become a bona fide child of the Most High God. May God bless, strengthen, and keep you.